7:30. So I'm going to go right to the North Hadley Fire Substation Committee report, because that's what the vast majority of you are here to talk about or listen to or whatever. And again, I'm going to try to keep this moving on track. So the only thing I would ask is that want to make sure that people who want to be heard will be heard, but just try to be respectful of time. And if somebody else already made a point, there, you know, if the point's been made, there's no need for four other people to make the same point. You know, we'll catch it from the nodding of the head. So again, we'll just try to keep it moving. All right, go ahead, John.
What are you doing?
It's not locked in.
Can you mind him its own? How do you lock that?
Yeah.
Just turn it?
Yeah, yeah.
I had a chance. Thank you from the other night. Thank you.
Okay.
There's more to it, though, I think.
There's a,
there's additional.
There's a police and fire in there. You're the liaison.
Okay.
So if you can read that after. All right, first of all, I'd like to introduce the committee. I'm John Michkowski, Senior, the Chairman of the Committee. My background is in construction, self-employed in the world and business, involved in fire and rescue for over 20 years, and involved in town politics for 30 years. Frank Quadro, he's a contractor of a building and estimator and a former finance committee. Willie Danlenko is our electrical inspector and also on the building committee. Howard Koski, engineer and attorney, and also a former finance committee member. Myron Chudzik, former fire chief, an estimator for construction and supervisor of construction projects. Marjorie Townsend, who serves on a historic commission, also a member of the Second Church in North Hadley. Mike Spanknebel is a fire chief, as advisory assistant on this committee. Mike Mason, police chief, also advisory. Don Pipchinski, neighborhood advisory. And Joyce Chunglo is liaison for police and fire and advisory on this committee.
I saw Howard. Did he leave again?
What's that?
Howard was here. I was just wondering if he wanted to come in. No?
He was here.
Oh, okay. All right, go ahead.
I'd like to read the report from the ad hoc committee to develop a plan to build a new fire substation in North Hadley. The committee has discussed having a colonial-looking building on the site of North Hadley Hall land, a building that covers 100 feet by 65 square feet of building and plus the parking. We decided to build this building in its full build-out instead of engaging into an idea of a phased build-out. The fire department substation will serve the present and future of this town. The substation would serve the entire central and north end of Hadley and serve as alternate backup for the fire department dispatch. There is millions of dollars of real estate north of Huntington Road that the station will cover. This site will provide off-street parking for the church to the north of the building, parking to the east of the building for future needs, etc., and limited access to the North Hadley Pond. Parking abutting to the rear of the building for department personnel with a drive-around flow of traffic. The building will serve as a civil defense office for major emergencies. The substation will serve as a backup communication center for the main station, whatever disrupted with power outage, weather-related issues, or being overutilized. A backup for the police to operate from, a future ambulance could be housed in the apparatus area if needed, and a much-needed storage above the offices and other rooms for police and fire. We have spent a great deal of time visiting surrounding towns fire and police departments for information concerning the needs and functions of the departments so that we can provide these services for our community and keep increasing the quality of services in the future. Through our extensive research, our estimated costs for an architectural building would be $3.6 million for the entire project. Okay, that's that. So I'd like to ask Selectman Bibchinski to give a little history on the fire station.
Could you pass out the rest of the thing to the other members that you have? Okay, I'm speaking as a member of the Ad Hoc Committee, not a member of the Select Board now. We all like to think we're Hadleyites living in Hadley, but most of us in this room aren't. We're all born in Cooley Dickinson some hospital, so most of us are Northamptonites. But I've lived at 234 River Drive for 63 of my 67 years, so I think I know what's happening in that area, the village. My father had a hay barn behind where I lived. It's no longer there. But the first fire truck in North Hadley came there in 1959. And in 1962, my father built an automobile garage, and he hired Fred Kaharski, who was the assistant fire chief for the town of Hadley. We had a red fire phone. I was 10 years old. Every time it rang, I knew something was really important going to happen. And my father allowed Mr. Kaharski to leave and attend the community in his fire duties. In 1963, the North Hadley Station was built. It has served the town well for about 53 years in that location. That fire station was built with a minimal amount of money and mostly all volunteer help. Let me see what else I can tell you about it. 63. The only thing that really has updated that building since its inception is the overhead doors. They've been replaced. Everything else in there remains the same. Mr. Michkowski will explain to you as we go along the saturation of that department and the saturation of the central fire station. There's a lot of nostalgia in the building next to us, in me. I went to school there in the hall. I attended social functions. There was a church there years ago I attended. I was a member of Hook and Ladder number 5 for over 20 years, and I left my business and grabbed the fire truck and saved many a house in Hadley too. So I know how important that station is today. It also is very important protecting the northern tier. There's millions of dollars worth of houses up there, and we're always going to have a call force regardless. And they report there, and they can get there much quicker than Central Station. So it's very important that we maintain a base there in the village for future police and fire work in the northern tier of our town.
Okay. Thank you, Donald. The fire chief is in Germany, so he can't be here to speak, but Joyce is the liaison for the fire and the police, and they both submitted letters there, and I would ask Joyce to read those folks.
The North Hadley Fire Station is also a priority, and a decision needs to be provided in order that I can make arrangements for potential storage solutions of equipment or upgrades to the current North Hadley Station that will allow our engine 3 to be moved up into engine 2's position temporarily until a decision or alternate space is identified. I have been requested to serve in an advisory role in an ad hoc committee that is being created to research the potential of North Hadley Station being built on the ball field next to the current North Hadley Hall. It is my understanding that this committee may be meeting soon, which may provide a viable option for this station. I have stated numerous times that it is my recommendation that a North Station is essential in the fire protection plan for the town of Hadley. I have provided statistical analysis of the response times for call force members with and without the station in place, and we will not be complying with any NFPA standard for a response time to residential fires in North Hadley. It is my opinion that we will be putting residents, businesses, and visitors of our community at risk if the station is closed. It is also my opinion that if a full-time department is put into place, the station will still be critical asset to the town's fire protection and also potential home of an additional ambulance if required in the future. The fire department will always have call force membership supporting a full-time department. And the police chief, I would like to submit this letter of support for the possibility of a project in which a North Hadley fire substation is constructed. I have acted in an advisory role on the ad hoc committee in which all facets of this project have been discussed. I have spoken at length with the fire chief, and I feel that the form of management and community risk assessment standpoint until the fire department is staffed more appropriately. A North Hadley station is important for the safety and security of the residents of this town. As an added advantage, it is possible that portions of the building may be dedicated for police use as well, and I support the idea of having a secondary dispatch location should problems arise at the center station, as well as having some secondary workstations for officers to work in the northern end of town. These are not necessities, nor do they solve our space issues, but they offer some needed relief to some identified problems with our current public safety complex. Submitted, Michael Mason, Chief of Police.
Thank you. Also, I would like to just share some information I received from an insurance company on fire protection and classification. In a protected clause, a building is located within 1,000 feet of a fire hydrant and within 5 road miles of a responding fire department. In partial protecting, the building is located over 1,000 feet from a fire hydrant, but within the 5 miles of a responding fire department. And the key in this thing is responding fire department. The Hadley Fire Department is the responding fire department. When alarm goes off in this town, it doesn't go off in South Airfield, it doesn't go off in Sunderland, it doesn't go off in Amherst. So therefore, Hadley is responding. And I look at it this way, as a department, say Sunderland or Amherst, where folks are saying, well, let them respond. Well, what's gonna happen to their budgets? This is a very expensive run operation and costs the taxpayers a lot of money for this protection. In other towns, they're not just gonna, they're scraping bottom, they don't have the manpower, and they're not gonna be taking over other towns. There is a mutual aid agreement that if there's a major fire that's out of control and it's beyond the grasp of the local fire, they can call surrounding towns to assist them in putting these fires out. But it just, that's some information I wanna put across. This is the plot plan of the area. To the north here is parking. We're taking because the church used all this for parking, and they're on this side of the road. So we're gonna put parking to the boundary on the north, and then there's parking all on the back boundary, which would give limited access to Mount Warner Lake. The parking in back of the building is going to be exclusively for fire personnel. There will be a drive around, past going around, right around the building here. We're going to request for a light that will be here, a stoplight activated by the fire truck. One here, because there's a curve right here, and one here, cars here. So as the fire engines discharge out, they can lock these lights into red and leave this way or that way, and there's no traffic here. And same vice versa, coming back in, they can lock those lights in, come in here, drive. If they're coming from the north, they can come in this way and then back right back in the station. And let's see, what else we got here? Let me get the schematic for the actually floor plan. There's going to be two 14 by 14 doors here, a 14 by 14 door here, and a 10 or 12 foot door here. This could be a sally port for the cruiser, or this could be for storage. But there's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4 doors. This is going to be the main entrance to this. This will be the E911 radio. This is the dispatch area with officers. There'll be a small kitchen here. This will be a small meeting room. And this will be an office area. These are all mechanical rooms, electrical, standby generator. And this will be utility, restroom, and this will be shower room. And in my eye, I got one eye here. I'm having trouble here. See, when I had two eyes, it would be no problem. All right, so this is the office, future office here. This is an overdrawn section of this is a large, probably a ladder truck. But this thing is designed so you would put a full-size truck in here and a mini pumper or ambulance or rescue. Say the ambulance would be to the back here and another engine in here. So that would be the floor plan. Now I would like to present pictures of our fire stations. What we have now. Yeah, turn it the right way. Good. Okay, this is the North Hadley fire station. There's an engine and a brush truck in there, but there is absolutely no room, if you can see, in that station. I mean, there's no room to move around in there. The Hadley station, the same story. This building, when it was built, it was fully, there was no extra room in the thing. It was never really built for a 5-year, 10-year, or 20-year period. It was just built when they occupied that building. That building was the capacity. We certainly don't want to make that same mistake again. We want to build for the future. Again, this is a substation, not a main station. So, you know, everybody's going to keep in mind, this station is there to protect you folks in North Hadley, the landowners in that town. And it's just not that. It's rescue. It's whether there's a tornado. You know, this complex is there to help the people on that end of town. So, and then I want to tell a little story about our tours around Western Mass. These are all fire stations. And every station that we toured, we went to Granby, Stardeerfield, we went Sunderland's not on here, and Belchertown's not on here. Every station is filled to capacity. And you ask, well, why didn't you build this for a bigger build-out? Everything was money. But then when you come back, you spend twice as much because every year the price goes up. You know, cost goes up. And you can look at this. I mean, there's some beautiful stations here. Stardeerfield is a real nice station. And we got some ideas a lot from talking to these fire chiefs that some of them put meeting rooms in it. And meeting rooms and rescue and fire don't mix. And especially they had a lot of trouble. It was somewhere up in Great Barrington. And the chief said if he could just get rid of that meeting room, because when they have fires, people park all they can, sometimes even get their engines out, and then go look for the driver. So Stardeerfield had that. Beautiful room. They stopped all community participation in that room. He said they came in there, they throw stuff around, they park cars around. It doesn't mix. You know, it's just like fire department with kids, that don't mix, you know. So we learned an awful lot about it. And then there's stations here that they were going to do phase build out. And I think it was it Granby or was it Belchertown with that sheetrock up in it?
Belchertown.
Right. They had over the apparatus room is where they cracked fire engines. They must have had, I don't know, probably 100 sheets, 4 foot by 10 foot sheets of plywood. And how many years ago was that?
20 years ago and hasn't moved.
And it's still sitting in the same spot they put it. There was never, once they built it, once they occupied, there was never no money to continue that. So, you know, I was looking at a facing in a fire department and the rest of the committee, it was just really strong voice, no. We're gonna go all the way complete when this truck enters there and occupies that building, that thing's ready to go. And there's not gonna be no problems after that. What we found out too is storage. In this town, there's a big problem with storage. Police need a lot of storage for their records. There's no place to do it. Upstairs, above that, all the office, we're gonna put a mezzanine there. So all these records are gonna be all locked up. There'll be a stairway going up. The police can have their records locked up. The fire can have their, and there's room for a lot of storage up there, which really there's no storage nowhere. I still want to go through some more departments because there's so much information, good information that they share. What we ask, what would you do different? And a lot of things you'd overlook, you know, like the meeting room, you wouldn't think, you know, that's important, you know, but we're building all these other buildings, so-called, and everybody's building meeting rooms. How many meeting rooms do we have? Do we really need, you know? So I'll open up to anybody that has any question.
Mr. Miskoczki, I like this design. And from the last meeting, I'm more comfortable with the pre-engineered building. But one thing I noticed in this station, do we have a hose drying tower in this thing?
You don't need that.
Right.
I'm going to tell you why. All the chiefs that we talked to, all the hoses are now, they're made, you don't dry them. You don't have to dry them. None of them dry it. Some of them got the hose rack, but not the tower. We were looking at that. And I'm glad you talked about the pre-engineered part because I just going to slip by that. That pre-engineered building is built. It's hurricane-proof, tornado-proof, and you can put any kind of facade you want it. If you want to put brick veneer on the front, you want to put stone on the front, you want to put shingles on the side, metal on the back, you can. There's a lot of options to do it. And it's possibly, it could drop the cost down several hundred thousand dollars.
It's going to be sprinkler protected, sprinkler system.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, good, because we need that for records.
Let me talk on that. The chief and Spencer come on strong on that.
Yeah.
I said, well, what did you put the sprinklers? He says, look at the equipment.
Yeah.
Multi-million dollars. Mm-hmm. And there's true events that fire stations burn down.
Yes,
he says, we're not going to lose our equipment. So we're under the radar with 6,500 square feet. Mm-hmm. We could get away with it.
Yeah, you don't
but want. What are we getting away with? If we ever have a fire, it's total disaster.
I agree with John about the meeting room because I was on the Hadley Fire Department for 43 years, and I was the first member from the center of the town to be inducted into the Hook and Ladder number 5 in North Hadley, and I'm proud of it. And I live in North Hadley, not far from the station. But after 43 years, retired as assistant fire chief, I wanted to do some training in the new station, but we couldn't because on the day that I was free, Amherst Hockey was up there. So I'd like to see that as a dedicated room. And as for financing, basic rule of finance is the money you have today is worth more than the money you're going to have tomorrow, and our bond rating is there, and we do have a need for this. And some people say that it's not going to affect your insurance rate. Well, let them look at that again, because you don't have this, and response times are lower. You know, it's going to take you longer. 5 minutes is a long time for the building to be burning, and whether you're going to save it or not, or save the people or not. And I see that we have a lot of thought put into it, and especially building towards the future, because I nicknamed our new station the barn. That's all it is, a glorified barn. And it, like John says, it was full to
2 months after, with no thought for the future. This has a future. You know, plans for it in the future, and you'd likely need the secondary dispatch. Say that something happened in the center of town, that blows that pile of sticks down, and then we have no dispatch. And there's no communication with fire, police, or other surrounding towns that we need to come in and help us. And I don't want to see the guys get shortchanged. I don't want to see it rushed. I don't want to see a building that's not planned for the future, but this is, and I don't think it's rushed because we have some good people on this board that know buildings and do their research. And I know John, personally, will do more than due diligence. And I trust exactly what he says. I'd like to see a metal roof on there, not like the pile of sticks where we have to put another roof on it. And the architect that did that one, well, you know, when he's asking me what a hose drying tower is, and he says he's built numbers of fire stations before, we have to tell him. And then we have problems with electrical switchgear in there that took up some valuable office space. But this, I am 100% in favor of this. And the town should act on this now and do the 100% build up and don't say, well, we're gonna do this, and then later on we're gonna do that. Like he says, we don't want to wind up with a 20-year-old stack of plywood there, like Belcher County.
So I'd like to follow up a couple of things that Dickie was talking about. The chief and Paxton, about the architect. They had a good building committee.
Yeah.
They had an architect that they straightened him out. You're going to build this way this town wants it. Not the way you think this town wants
no
it.
Monuments
and
to the
and that's that was a key thing, that we got people that are in the building. I mean, Oquadro, he's a Class A person. He understands all that, and he can pinpoint everything there. He's a professional estimator. And was it in Belchertown, the chief's there? What the heck did they tell us? He made another comment about something. I forget what the heck that was.
Belchertown, you know, they're one of the biggest landmass towns in Massachusetts, and I'm surprised they don't have more substations than they do, and I don't know how ISO, the insurance services organization, set in the tax, the insurance rates for that town on some of the furthest run that they have, and they have a lot of a mixed bag in Belchertown. They have the old state hospital there, and they have some places where they have industrial areas, and Hadley has it too. Like, this will be the closest, when you get an alarm to a hotel or something like that where you have a high life hazard, they're gonna run. And they should be running every structural alarm that we have. And that's important, because ISO is looking at how many engines show up. Sometimes they're not counting heads, they're just seeing how much apparatus is showing up. And with the new apparatus coming, I have no idea how big it is or whatever it's going to be, but we take care of the equipment, at least when I was involved with that. We take care of that equipment so that they can take that engine that it's replacing and put it in reserve in North Haven. So we do need the pumping capacity that it brings with it. If you look at the Walters of Hadley fire, that's just a small strip. About how much apparatus was at that one. And that they have bunk rooms for standby, because if you're having a blizzard there, you can station people there, because, you know, I'm not gonna put snowshoes on and go over there. I'm done with that.
No. So I'm just thinking, just to try to keep the conversation focused, I think there are a couple of decision points in here. The first one, and I'm taking this from your presentation, John, the first one is there a question as to whether or not we need a substation in North Hadley? Because if people are thinking the answer to that may be no, then kind of renders the rest of this discussion a moot point. Then if the agreement is, yeah, generally speaking, it seems that people think we need a substation in North Hadley, then the second question becomes, is this the best location? And then if the answer to that, you know, yes or no on that one, then the third step would be, is this the right building in that location? So I'm wondering if we can just try to break the discussion down that way and maybe just start it with, does anybody want to talk about the merits of having a substation in North Hadley at this point. I mean, I think you've already...
Number one, can you say there's not going to be any fires in North Hadley? And people with million-dollar homes are going to be pretty upset if their house is burning down and no one comes here.
John, I think you and Myron have already made your argument for it. I'm just questioning, is anybody want to...
My brother Myron, this is Eddie. He's in
law. Myron's got gray hair.
Gerald. And you sit in the back of church too. But if we can, you know, if anybody wants to debate that point, I think now's a good time to debate that particular point.
Madam Chair, I would think the letter that the liaison for the police and fire department read from the fire chief tells you exactly, we need this station, he said, and we need it for our call force. Who better would you want an answer from than your fire chief? That we need this station in North Hadley, irregardless if we have a full-time department someday at Center Station. We still need the substation in North Hadley.
I think one of the things that I mentioned last night, of course you all know how I feel about the North Hadley Hall, but as far as I'm concerned, it should come down, and I've said that for years. This is nothing new to anybody.
Mm-hmm. As long as it doesn't fall in this new station.
I know, but I mean, it's the number one asset that we have in this town is we own that piece of property. Mm-hmm. And it's not that we have to go out and buy another piece of property. Mm-hmm. It was not approved at the last town meeting. It did not pass. It failed when we tried to buy property in North Hadley. Mm-hmm. It didn't go anywhere. So, number one, we own the land already. Number two, it was a takedown thing. And then the other thing is that it's not a guarantee that Mr. Greenbaum's plan is going to go through with the Zoning Board of Appeals, and we're going to end up holding the building anyway. Because he's got to prove to them that they're going to let him put 10 units in there, mm-hmm. which, number one, would set a precedent for this town. We don't have that anywhere else in town. It would be a change in what our bylaws are, and I'm not sure where that's going to go.
I actually heard last night that Shady Glen was converted very similarly to what is being requested.
I'm sorry, we cannot hear you back here.
I'm so quiet.
I know.
It was brought out last night at the Buildings Committee meeting that that Shady Glen actually was converted, the
Shady Lawn.
The nursing home.
Can I explain that? I was at the same meeting, and I did multitude of research after that comment was heard. That comment was made by Mr. Wiskevich of the Municipal Building Committee, and the variance that they received is an illegal variance today. Any variance has to stand alone on its own merit, and there is nothing that exists as a precedence when it comes to variations. It was the lesser of two evils. The townspeople that lived around there did not want a rehab facility there. And so they accepted apartments. And it was a legal variance by the Zoning Board of Appeals, and they'll admit to it that it was, but it pacified the neighbors that lived there, and everybody ended up with a happy situation in the end.
Can you guys hear Donald okay?
Yeah, he's great.
I just want to make sure.
He's great.
So just, again, I just want to come back to the first question, okay? Is there, and I will say, I initially questioned whether or not we needed a substation in North Hadley. And after a fair amount of conversation with both chiefs, after listening, you know, to some of the work that have been done, I personally am now of the opinion that yes, we should have a presence in North Hadley. But I know that not everybody feels that way. And what I don't want to have happen is we walk out of the room and then I'm getting phone calls of people saying, "We don't even need a substation in North Hadley. Why are you doing this?" So I just want the opportunity for that dialogue to take place if anybody wants to have it. Jerry, do you? How you?
No.
You good? Okay.
Yeah.
So, okay. Just making sure. Okay. Now the.
Tim wanted to do.
Yeah.
Go to the second question.
Right. Go to the second question. Yeah.
If I may,
mm-hmm.
as a zoning enforcement officer, there's been a couple statements that were made. Variances are very specific. They are not precedent setting in any way. They are specific to the property only. You cannot argue from one place to another that just because somebody else got it, you can get it. With regard to the variance, it is something that needs to be addressed, and the zoning board can address it very, very quickly. And they would like to address it extremely quickly. And we do have it postponed. They want some direction from your board from tonight.
Mm-hmm.
And if you wish to have that first hearing so discussed, which we all believe should be discussed, that question in regards to if he will be granted that variance could be very quick, and then we have the 20-day appeals period. So that certainly could happen at a very quick statement. With regard to that second question,
which is that the best location?
Is that the best location? It was discussed. Now, I will premise that the Municipal Building Committee fully agrees that we do need and we should have a substation up there. The real question is, where should it be? Our statement last night from the Municipal Building Committee was, we are still standing behind our first vote with regard to that the town went through a town meeting vote, and it was requested that and granted to try to sell North Hadley Hall, and we still agree as a committee that that should take place. But your board has that final say on how that's going to go forward. Now, as far as we own this property, I think you need to, and what we haven't done, and I brought this up last night, we really never ever looked at the pros and cons of should it be on this site or should it be on another site. And that should be done at some point. And I think some of the major factors that need to be addressed is, one, the price that you'll get for the property for the sale. Two, the amount of money, which probably is in excess of $100,000 to take that building down. And three, the taxes that you're going to generate over time. So if you correlate all that together, yeah, you have your free property, but does that correlate to a price that you can purchase another piece of property? And we're talking 3 acres, so it's not that large. But those are the things that you guys have to decide upon by yourselves. Is it the best site or not?
Mm-hmm. No, just Tim, to clarify, so you're saying that the pros and cons should be discussed. The Municipal Building Committee has discussed the pros and cons of this, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I thought you were saying that you hadn't, but...
We have, but I think it needs to be looked at.
Right, and where...
Very precisely, on now that we can start looking at dollar figures.
Okay,
they
gotcha.
Have to be looked at.
Mm-hmm.
But nobody has an actual dollar count for how much to take down that building. What did it cost us, Jerry, to take down the...
60,000.
Jen? To back up his story, I don't know if I'm going to back it up. They presented a lot to buy for it, and it failed at town meeting. It was quite obvious that the community overwhelmingly voted it down. You guys sent out an RFP to look for land while this was going on. You got nothing back. You got a piece of land over here, I guess, did you? Local. But you get nothing in North Hadley. This department operated there for 50-something years, and it operated there well. It services that whole area, and now we want to move it somewhere when we got the opportunity because we own the land. Let's go buy some other land. I think that's just kind of crazy. Absolutely.
Well, I think
the building is bigger than the other one. There's a lot more that this offers, and it fits on that lot. And the setback is further back than the The hall is 17 feet, and I think the church is 11 feet off the road, off the blacktop. So this is 40-something feet.
Could you just give a little bit more information on your price, John, the $3.6 million that Frank estimated? Is
yeah,
that...
Hold on, let me find here.
I'm just confused because we're starting to talk about taking down North Hadley Hall. Right now it's still standing. There's conversation.
Is well, you also just, we got a thing from this.
Whatever the building is, the building price is...
Is it in the 3.6?
I'm wondering if, have they factored any demolition? So the 3.6 is north of that, if in fact...
No, why would we factor in demolition when we weren't charged at that?
I just want to be
right.
Clear on what's in and what's out.
Well,
so just because Joyce had, you know, brought up some other issues. I mean, right now we still have Mr. Greenbaum sitting here with an offer on the table.
It's not clear as to how this is being paid for. It's not been mentioned. What you're talking about
yep.
now, how is it going to be paid for?
Well, it would have to go to town meeting for,
okay,
like any other
what?
Building. Clearly, it would be a no one's writing a check for 3.6, so
exactly.
It would be a borrowing
so
article.
It would be a borrowing article for over a 20-year period, as were the other buildings, the other fire station, and the elementary school that we built the same year.
But
okay.
Depending on the timing of it, there's a whole capital schedule, so it's possible, depending on how everything else gets prioritized, that you know it could theoretically be covered without taxes going up because we have some debt coming off. But we have many, many other competing projects, so we're just trying to get a
understood.
Handle
thank
on
you.
It.
And that is good business for the community. They're,
just
they're,
ducks, but
they got a debt exclusion coming off in 2020, so what the proper thing to do is to address your buildings and feed them in there without a significant tax increase to the taxpayers.
Understood.
And that's what's under works now.
The two buildings we're talking about is an architectural building is approximately $3.6 million. That's a carte blanche building. Now, the committee has already voted. I'm not a voting member, but the committee has voted to change to an architectural design building,
no.
Which...
Not change, look into.
Oh, look into then, okay,
right.
Excuse
We're
me.
We're going to look into the total cost, so then we can compare them and come back to you folks in before town meeting and said, this is what we can get. Mm-hmm. We're looking for longevity with these buildings.
Mm-hmm.
We're looking for a 40-year roof. You know, there's a lot of factors in this, so, you know, there's a lot of things to do, and I hope that OMI or whatever you call them on board, that we can engage with him immediately.
Mm-hmm.
But the difference between the two buildings, the architectural design would drop to $2.8 million from 3.6, which is a big difference.
So you don't know that figure for sure?
So
no, we don't know any of these figures for sure at this point.
Right.
The price that Frank gave across is actually bid prices. I even talked to different contractors that bid fire departments, and they ran from 400 and something a square foot down to 300. Frank took in his bids, actual bids that went on, he took the median price from 375 to 325. He put the middle quote on this square footage building. So they're in the ballpark. What's
question
going
in
on?
The back there?
Have you done an environmental impact study for this particular site, or are you not there yet?
No, what we did already, we went in front of the Conservation Commission, okay, because it's in with the 35-foot setback of the Wetlands Act, not the Rivers Act. The Rivers Act stops at the below the dam. And Janet Stone walked the property. And the fence line in the back is where that's the break line, right there, where that is. And what we got from Time Bond Engineering was an estimate of $125,000 to comply with MS4 drainage. That law now, this is a new building and new development, that all water that's gonna be shed from the building, from the parking lot, is gonna be contained and dispensed on the premises, and not on their neighbors, not on the pond.
I would like to ask that you guys think about the new EPA drainage things that are, I forget what it's called, but the thing that was brought
CPA funded?
No,
No, the new mandate from the EPA.
I think at the end of the storm.
That's what four is.
And that's four, stormwater.
Just to make sure that that's being factored in.
Our highway superintendent is looking at the whole town for that. We're writing the specification now, adhering to it, because if we don't adhere to it, there's fines as high as $16,000 a day.
So I just wanted to make sure that that's being, you know.
I think John answered that previously. The in-ground storage is gonna keep the stormwater runoff on site. It's not gonna run into the Lake Warner.
And there is sewer there for, there's no, you don't need no septic, and there's town water there, so.
Tim?
So when they go out to finance this, it's gonna be bundled anyways. All projects are bundled anyways when we go out to bond?
Not necessarily.
It depends. I mean, that the funding piece of it's a whole separate discussion, because there are a variety of ways to handle that. And again, these projects may, they have to get approved, first of all, and they have to, timing issues.
Madam Chair, I think I've got a very important question that may pacify a lot of this, and that I'd like to ask Mr. Nyhart. If the building was not there, the community hall, would that lot be big enough to pacify the municipal building committee?
Oh, of course.
It would?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
But again, I go back to that fundamental question that we brought. I mean, I think everybody agrees. Whatever the fire substation is going to be built, it really gets down to, should this be the only place that we should be looking at? And John knows my position in many hats I'm wearing.
Like,
he doesn't like it. But I go back to the fundamental question, which we really haven't studied well. Is this the best place that this should go? And I go back to the what we've had before with regard to Joel. We've gone through a year and a half discussion and votes on selling this property. I think that we, at the last second, we've cut this off and gone on this new path, and we haven't finished the negotiation with this gentleman. He has come to this town on his own merits with a very good proposal. It is up to your board to finish that discussion. And if you guys cannot come up with something, everybody's going to be 100% behind this process. But I think that has to be finalized. Mm-hmm. And then you go forward and say, yes, this is the best position. This is the best place for it, because you got a lot of costs that you have to look at up front here.
Joel, you actually had your hand up before. Did
I have
you
a
want
couple
to talk?
Things I'd like to say.
Please.
Okay. So I'm not disputing that Hadley needs another substation. Mm-hmm. If the professionals say we do, then we do. I can't believe we're sitting here tonight actually suggesting tearing down North Hadley Hall. I mean, that's one of the most significant historical buildings in this town. I mean, many folks here went to school here. It's the central focus of historic North Hadley Village, which is beautiful, okay? So what you're trying to do is there's talk tonight about, I mean, this building is on your website. You click North Hadley, Town of Hadley, and there's a picture of North Hadley Hall. It's a beautiful building. So you're talking about tearing it down and making a fire station your focus of North Hadley. It's wrong, okay? It's wrong. Is there anyone here from the Historical Commission? I don't see anyone.
Here, she just raised her hand. You're not? Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
So, I mean, I am a little biased. You know, I like old buildings, I like North Hadley, and I also like safety for the community as well. So, you know, I'm not against this. But, I mean, you're talking about thinking intelligently for the long term. This building may or may not be beneficial for the long term. That's up to you. I think the land that you're putting it on is far too small. The building that you propose is larger than North Hadley Hall, which is already a large building. This building's even bigger. And it covers the whole piece of land. It's either going to be a steel building and it's surrounded by blacktop, and it's not going to look good there. You know, the whole village is historical in nature. and then you're going to have this big monstrosity. It's not, I don't think it's attractive, I don't think it's the right location, and I don't think it's planning for long term because the land is too small. You'll outgrow this in a year.
Well, sir, where would you put it then? This is not the right place to put it. Where would you put it?
North Hadley continues for quite a long while.
What's available? Why don't you continue?
What's available?
Cooking route.
Yeah, what's
available? And if you're talking $3.5 million for a building, $500,000 for land is not a big deal, I think.
It does. I'd like to ask Mr. Nyer a question. Okay.
Yeah, go ahead.
How long have you been on that municipal building committee?
Since its inception, it's over 2 years.
In 2 years, you didn't find a spot. Is it going to take another 2 years to find a spot?
It's not.
We got a spot.
It's not up to us to find.
Well,
a spot.
You're talking as a municipal building. I didn't hear any other spots in 2 years. This spot's been there all the time.
Okay,
yeah,
so
go back to
so let's go back to the point. So, and again, just to maybe it's good to bring make sure everybody kind of recap the history here. Tim touched on some of it. So, a while back now, there was a town meeting vote to sell the property. There has been no town meeting vote suggesting the property be torn down. That because the discussion didn't take place, it was never on the table. It was put out to the voters that the property be sold. So that really is the only time town meeting has spoken about this, except to John's point, when a proposal for land was presented to town meeting, town meeting very loudly voted that down. The question becomes on that particular front though, why? Because I think people voted no for a variety of reasons. The one that I heard more often than not was, you guys don't have a plan for anything, which is in large part the reason that the library was also voted down. So I don't want to make the mental leap that because people said no to a $500,000 parcel that no one could articulate to them exactly what it was going to be used for, that it means that town meeting would never vote for land for a North Hadley substation. So I'm struggling with that, and I personally am also struggling with the fact that we did enter into an agreement when we went out to bid to in good faith with somebody. To Tim's point, I do think that process needs to be finished, and when the go-ahead was given to the committee, when we formed the committee and said, yeah, go ahead and investigate this, it was in cooperation with Mr. Greenbaum, who said that he was amenable to a parceling off plan two or?
That's right.
Okay. But I think that some things have changed as well. So I think we need to bring that part of it into the mix.
I have no problem with Mr. Greenbaum and the way he takes care of his property. They're impeccable. He's taken old houses in the village and turned them to magnificent buildings again. You know, the old Scott property is something special to look at. And I'm sure Mr. Greenbaum would do the same with this. But since day one, Selectman Chundalo has said she wanted to tear down this building since day one when this came from town meeting. So it isn't nothing new on the table. She's been clamoring to do that since day one. And as far as I'm concerned, this evening, we haven't got into the discussion yet. We're talking about North Hadley Hall. Shortly after this, we're going to get into the discussion with Mr. Greenbaum and North Hadley Hall. We're just getting new information that was decided 2 days ago from our two liaisons to do the negotiation. This building is still in the negotiation phase, as far as I'm concerned. And we haven't got a signed agreement of what's in it at this point. Until we have that discussion a little later on in this meeting, then we'll make a decision. If we're going to sell the building, maybe it's in the best interest of Hadley to retain the building. One thing that I'm concerned about now is where we're going to keep these trucks. And I've heard figures tossed around. If we had to go out and rent a place for these trucks, it's going to be $5,000 a month. That's $60,000 a year. That's almost the amount of money it would cost to tear down the building. You know, so we're going to have this discussion shortly on the next subject matter, and I think we are almost ready to wrap up with North Hadley, unless this board is willing to make a decision. I don't think I am at this point. I want to have the discussion about North Hadley Hall before a decision is made about North Hadley Hall.
Yeah, and I agree. Again, I'm just trying to make it clear to folks that right now what's on the table, because we keep talking about lot size, and to the extent there's an argument that it appears that this building, one argument against the building is that we're pigeonholing it or shoehorning it, I guess is the right word, into an inappropriate lot size. Right now, I am very concerned about that, and I'm also concerned about the change in the village atmosphere in North Hadley. I mean, we would be completely blocking the view. Not that the pond is so much that attractive
anymore,
but you know, again, it's green space that it would be green removed. Obviously, if we buy a parcel of land and we put something on it, that too is green space that would be removed. But again, it is in the village center, so I'm just struggling with that. Hang on, Jerry, you haven't said about this.
I am just listening tonight to everything here. I know that there's a community up there that feels differently about this too, and that the neighbors that are up there, and I think that they need to be heard from as well. I appreciate that the committee has gone out there and devised the building. I personally think the building's too big. I don't know why we need a substation bigger than our station in the center of town. I hear what you're saying, that you outgrow these things.
The station in town is way too small.
But now we're going to have two stations that are going to be moved, and the north station is going to be bigger. Okay?
No.
And so I just think that it's big.
You know,
I can listen to I'll listen to you. I hear you, and I'm not. And then we have professionals, and I trust the professionals on that. So I hear you, but I think a lot of people are going to have the same opinion that our substation is bigger than our center station.
You know, I'm going to tell you guys the truth. What I'm hearing there is the most majority of people are telling me, let them tear that building down. People even in this town hall that I never expect them to say that have told me. The meeting after the ZBA. Women came outside there and told me the best thing is just let them tear that building right down.
Again, we have to be careful.
And again, you can negotiate all you want. The ZBA says no to it. One vote. In his agreement, he's going to walk. What's he going to do with it? So negotiate all you want. The ZBA is the chief negotiator.
Are there people here who had their hands up? Terry, I think you wanted to say something. Yeah.
Mr. Greenbaum mentioned what would this substation look like with all parking around it. And what he's proposing is not only going to have parking around that whole building all up and down the street, because he's only going to provide parking enough for who actually lives there. 10 apartments times 2 cars, it's 20 cars, and then they're going to have their visitors, and they're going to be all along that road, which is going to create a safety issue there as well, because then they're in the road, and people have to drive in the middle of the road to get by those cars, is my opinion. Second, the size, the lot that that building sits on. First, the lot that that building sits on. When my husband and I purchased the home quite a few years ago, there was a lead paint issue there. And so when he maintains the outside of that building, are we going to run into the lead paint issue again with the drains that are on that property? Where does the runoff water go with the drains that are on that property that are between that building and Lori Fitzgibbons? So I have a concern about that as well, revisiting that whole issue again from 25 years ago.
Joel, did you want to respond to that? Or you started to?
Yeah, I'd like to.
Yeah, good.
No one's more concerned than having properties appear well-maintained and in order than me, I think. And so, I don't know if you saw my architect plans, but the original plans had parking for 15 spaces on the north side of the building. So the building proposes 6 studios, which would be lived in by one person, and 4 one-bedrooms, which could be lived in by 2. Okay, so that's a total of 12 cars. Plans for 15, but the parking could easily be 20. That's all on the north. 10 and 10 with the dumpster in the middle and leaving the field open. So I can promise you that there would not be, this is not an animal house, these are young working professional types.
And I don't doubt that, but I also know that, and I do respect that because your other rental properties, they're respectful people that live there too.
Yeah, it would be just like the one across the street.
But there's still parking on the street, and so.
Who's parking on the street?
The one that lives next to me, because evidently they don't have enough parking in their yard.
The blue house?
That's right, for visitors, so that's an issue, and that's where I foresee the large apartment.
No, I understand that, but this would be a building where we would build a parking lot, not.
Well, you have enough parking in that house, that home too. I don't know what their issues.
If you have a problem with that house, you can call me and I'll work it out, this is all new to me.
But beyond that, just beyond that, it's not just that house.
Okay, yeah, so let's.
Safety reasons as well, as would all the cars potentially parking on the road.
Yeah.
Okay.
So are they willing to not put no parking on the road signs?
Okay, but we'll. No, we haven't, that's why, so I guess the question is, David, we also have an update on a proposal from Mr. Greenbaum.
Right. We received it just the other day, and so it's in front of you for informational purposes. It's scheduled for a true discussion with the board on the 31st. I'm sorry that the letter and the timing requirements for posting didn't quite gel like I think everybody would like us to, but we do have that revised proposal from Mr. Greenbaum. With that he's offering a, and correct me if I'm wrong, he's offering $100,000 for the whole parcel, including the ball field. He's asked for a decision by a certain date in September. So when we talk about it on the 31st, we'll have to keep that date in mind. Did I represent that correctly?
It is correct. Mind you.
Pending a couple.
The lawyer that drafted that up is just accustomed to normal residential closings.
Mm-hmm.
The dates are flexible.
Okay, thank you.
You know,
okay. Thanks for that clarification.
And my whole contingent on this, even though I've said what I've said, but that's my own personal feelings, is that I too want to do what's best for the town. We've been at this negotiations with you, and it's changed umpteen times, and yet, on the other hand, I want to be sure that there's a piece of property that there can be a substation on. You know, whether it be that piece of property, or we need to make sure that there is a piece of property in North Hadley.
I completely understand, and I
mean, that's, I'm not against.
I want to do what's best for the town,
yeah,
too, and that's why I started the process the way I did, but as I saw how things were going,
mm-hmm,
And I made a personal decision as to what I thought was best for me and the town and the people of North Hadley. I changed my mind.
The one problem that I really have in this agreement now before me, there is nothing in there that allows people access to the lake.
Whatever.
Nothing at all in there.
Okay.
So that means if you take over the property, our access to the lake is gone forever. If that lake gets cleared up someday and we want to use it for canoes and kayaks, we will not have a way to get to it.
Donald, I don't think that's a fair statement because,
yeah,
as David said,
there,
we're going to discuss that at a later point in time. So
I'm open to anything, though.
Yeah.
But there is a boat ramp there.
Yeah, but it's not in here.
No, but we're not.
There's a boat ramp.
Yeah.
And people do have access
for discussion.
But we'll talk about that again.
So somebody's saying in the back here, Kathy?
I just wanted to sort of represent Park and Rec. It hasn't been brought up at all.
Mm-hmm.
And speaking of safety, I'm 110% for the safety of our town. And this fire department seems amazing to me.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it would be silly not to. But going back to safety, I just want to again say that Park and Rec is at that North Hadley Hall. And every single day for the rest of this summer, we have children there. And I want to be very clear at this meeting and in the future that that building is 100% safe, and all of the kids going to programs at Park and Rec and myself showing up to work every day there along with my coworker are safe in this amazing building. And I agree that it's a nice historical building. But I just want, no one's talked about Park and Rec right now. I'm not going to take that personally because I don't. But I just want you to remind yourselves that children are in that building every day. You can talk about tearing it down, you can talk about building whatever you want to, but let's remember that we have a working department there every day. And that department is being asked to move in September or October, or by October, because this negotiation has been going on forever, and I'm not able to do my job, which is future programming for this building, in this building, because of the lack of, I call it, communication. So I just wanted to be very clear again about the safety in town. I 100% support a North Station, but I also 100% support the children and families of this town, the adults doing Zumba there, that it is a safe building, right? Let's make sure we say that out loud. Thank you.
Yeah, we're aware of that.
Where would they put you?
I don't know where they're going to put me.
So, Tim, again, the Municipal Building Committee, they took a formal position on this or no?
They have in the past. They didn't.
We have
again last night. They have in the past taken it.
And the formal position of the Municipal Building Committee is that this is not the best location. It's not that they're against a substation. They don't believe that this is the best location.
Well, we evaluated it based on the requirements set forth by the fire department, and we felt at that time that it was not the best location. Again, I keep on reiterating the same thing. I think what's happened with the size of this building is that it's based not on the property, it's based on design parameters that were set up, and that's not the way you should always design. You should design based on where you're going to fit it. There was a statement from Jerry that he felt it was too big. Could very well be too big. Again, I think you need to get some professionals in here, evaluate it properly, the site, and see if something can actually fit there. Based on the requirements of the possible buyer, can it work? Yes, it can, but I think we've gone around, approached this in the wrong direction. Get a professional in there, look at the site, see what he needs, what our needs are, and design the building based on the site. And it's a problem. What they did was put a square in. There are a lot of other issues relative to our zoning with the way it's been set up. I reiterated that at the last meeting, and that has to be again brought up.
15 minutes ago, Mr. Neihardt said if the hall was not there, it would be a viable site and a good site if the hall was not there.
That's true.
Yeah, I heard that. So what's the pleasure of the board now in terms of next steps? Do we want to, are people comfortable voting up, voting down? Do we want to defer until the discussion takes place with, David, you look like you have thoughts.
Yeah, I was thinking that form follows function.
Mm-hmm.
And we started the evening out 3 hours ago with a discussion about where does the town need to be in the next 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
This proposal here contemplates that we're going to be getting into the ambulance business, a discussion we really haven't had.
Mm-hmm.
Talked about decentralizing some of the communications, also putting together a police presence that we haven't discussed. So I think that the committee should be commended for putting together a multi-purpose building, which is designed to the future, but the future has to be decided by the select board in order for them to fully embrace what's on the table right now.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so what's the pleasure of the board in terms of, Donald, you went on record saying that you're not comfortable?
I would suggest we wait till the 31st, and the reasoning behind that is I want the vote with a full board. Mr. Wiskiewicz is not here this evening,
mm-hmm.
and I think it's imperative we take this vote with a full board.
Joyce, Jerry, head.
Fine with that, but I don't want to put it off much longer.
No,
it's not fair to the people that have worked so hard on this.
Yep, I agree.
That's a deadline.
Mm-hmm. 31st,
yeah.
I think, right?
So then the ZBA is 2 to 3 weeks after that. I wonder if we have even time to put it to town meeting when you guys get done with this.
When's the ZBA meeting again?
They're waiting.
They're waiting for our decision.
Oh, for our decision, okay.
I don't know why. A week after.
Yep.
This is all August, so we could do it the first part of September.
Mrs. Chungwa, do you have an opinion of this situation? How do you feel? Not to put you on the spot or anything, but...
Did I miss something?
Yeah, exactly. No, she 17 times Joyce has told everybody in this room how she feels about this.
No, I'm talking about the date. I'm not talking about, excuse me, I didn't mean that. No, I'm talking about the date. Are you ready to make a decision tonight? Or do you want to wait till the 31st with a full board?
Wait for the 31st.
Can I ask you a question before you do this?
Yep, last one and then we're moving on.
Why don't you let the process go if it's going to be allowed on that site? First, if it's not allowed, then there's no decision you've got to make. Why don't you do that? That would make more sense than anything, and that's all we're doing is playing catch from the ZBA to the selectmen. Back to the ZBA, everybody is bouncing this ball back and forth. The main question is, if it's allowed, it's allowed. If it isn't, there's no negotiating. It's over. Mm-hmm. So why don't you let it do that? That probably makes too much sense.
My understanding is that the ZBA didn't want to hear this.
Because the selectmen were there that made a comment.
Right. That's
right.
Why they postponed
right.
it.
Right.
Because somebody from the select board said a new proposal came.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Something that wasn't mentioned tonight, and I understand there's an additional 20 feet being requested.
No,
that is out.
It's out. This is full property.
So it's
the full property.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
The full property.
Correct.
Okay, so
there's no.
I understand now by that comment. Thank you.
Okay, so my understanding was that the ZBA postponed it because they were waiting for a recommendation, a formal recommendation from the select board. Not because they were, because somebody said that there was
I asked you folks for a meeting to vote this up or down. Somehow the meeting disappeared. The ZBA was booked. I attended that thing and it's just like that's why nothing's done in this town. Everything is just the cans kicked down the road. Who's on first, who's on second? Car 54, where am I? I can't understand this. You know, to me it's very simple. Notify the ZBA, let the ZBA vote on its merits on this and on Mr. Greenbaum's merits, and it's done.
Yep, I have no problem with the ZBA
right.
hearing it. My understanding was that it was on their
well,
end that they didn't want
the
it.
The selectmen did
they
say
want,
so.
They were waiting for us
they were waiting
right.
to make
yeah.
a recommendation.
Yeah.
They are waiting
exactly.
for us to
yeah.
make a recommendation.
So and if that's the case, what I'm hearing is that the board wants to make sure that we
well,
have five people
I don't think they were waiting
here.
For a recommendation. I think they were waiting for us on our decision of the proposal.
That's correct.
Not,
which is
not
our
a,
recommendation.
Not any of our recommendation, but what we decided to do with the piece of property.
Right.
Before you could move forward to do whatever you want, nay
yep.
or say.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But again, if you move forward to give him all the property and the ZBA votes no, he's out of there anyways. He's not going
to
buy that contract.
According
which
to
is
the
process.
Contract,
right.
That's the process.
Oh,
yes.
Yeah. That's a good process.
You know, the biggest thing, I want to make sure we're acting in good faith with Mr. Greenbaum. That's my major thing.
Absolutely.
You know, we've got to follow protocol. And I want to make sure we're acting in good faith.
The ZBA is the good faith because
Jane?
That's what tells
but we're in negotiating the agreement, John.
Okay, go ahead.
Didn't the town vote to sell the whole property?
Yes.
And that was the town's will.
That was the will of the town.
And so that's where the town thinks this is right now.
Oh, yeah, except for people who were aware of the research into this, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm just
glad yeah,
it
that
wasn't discussed about the
yep.
fire department.
Tim, Leslie?
Or
one of the things that the board can do to give direction to the ZBA, the hearing was split into two. The first hearing was related to the number of units.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, you can give direction to the ZBA right now and say, go ahead and have that hearing. We can have, that could be heard on its own merits. And if that is voted down, I guess then you guys have some direction.
Mm-hmm.
So it is true that a person can go forward on your behalf because you're the owners of that property. and say, yes, you may go in front of the ZBA and request that variance. And that certainly could be a quick way of getting this whole process.
That's only half the answer, Tim.
It is.
You know that.
And
you know that that's only half the answer.
It's more than half.
That's only half.
More than half.
The ZBA is looking for direction from this board as to how we want to proceed with that.
You can't tell the ZBA what to do.
But it is something that you guys can look at.
Well, then, Mr. Greenbaum, could go before the ZBA and ask for the variance for the 10 units?
For the 10 apartments. If you guys, as the owners of
that
property,
that would tell us where we were totally.
Yeah, I have no...
Unless you have other plans after you didn't do the 10 units.
Yeah.
No, I have no other.
No other plans, okay. So...
I've been contacted by my neighbors, and there are complaints that 10 units are too much for that building. So there's going to be opposition to the amount that he's requesting. Maybe he needs 10 to make it profitable. I don't know. If he had 8, maybe it's not profitable to do the project. You know, I don't know. But.
Go ahead, David.
Can I respond to that?
David, hang on.
No, please.
There's a large demand in this area for smaller apartments.
Mm-hmm.
My desire is not to build 3-4 bedrooms and fill them up with college kids. My desire is to build single person apartments. 6 of them are studios. It's usually one person. 4 of them are one bedrooms, probably for couples or one person. This building's quiet. It's quiet.
So again, these are all, I mean, these are zoning related issues and design issues, etc.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, is there any reason, again, other than the reluctance of the ZBA to, it seems that if we're following the process, they should hear this project on its own merit, just from a zoning standpoint.
And what about this project?
I'm just talking about one right now, in terms of process. That's the proposal that's on the table.
Know, my answer to Mr. Greenbaum on that, there was a major support in this area, supposedly for tiny houses. And look at the overwhelming vote of not allowing them here.
Well, that was
it's a different scenario, but it's another tiny house for a single family person.
Right. She came in the back door, though. He's going through the proper channels. That's the difference.
David,
she snuck in. He's trying to be up front.
Sometimes it's helpful to focus in on the process.
Right.
All right. So we went to the town meeting and we asked them, do you want us to sell the property or not? Town meeting said yes. Overwhelmingly, they said
mm-hmm.
yes, sell the property.
Mm-hmm.
So we went to the Historic Commission. We said, put together a set of historic preservation restrictions for the exterior of the building. And using those as a template, we went out and we did an RFP. If you remember, we went through 3 different drafts of the RFP before it was acceptable to the board. We went through the RFP process, we got 2 responses. You took a formal vote to accept a proposal. That proposal has been amended, and that's really where we are right now. That's the only thing that we're really talking about with respect to that. The ZBA is a separate process. They have a formal notification. They'll have a formal hearing. People have an opportunity to have their say. They'll take a vote. That vote will be recorded. It might be appealed.
Right. And aren't they part of the checks and balances of the town, the existence of a ZBA? Right.
Right.
They exist for a particular purpose, not...
But the ZBA vote has nothing to do with your vote.
That's my point.
Yeah.
That's my point. And I think that's the point that you're both making as well. And again, I was just reacting to my understanding that the ZBA didn't want to hear this for whatever reason until the select board... So, I mean, it would seem to me that it would be quite possible for the ZBA to go forward with a hearing.
Right.
And again, just on the merits of the zoning issues, regardless of the will of the select board, all that stuff, because it is a ball that's getting tossed back and forth, because depending on how the ZBA rules, much of this could be a moot point. So,
I think the merit...
Well, can I just ask, is anybody... I don't know why we wouldn't reach back out to the ZBA and have them just go ahead.
I agree.
With their hearing.
We were waiting on the information from this. It couldn't be released, the ZBA meeting. I don't find anything in here that makes a difference on the hearing for the ZBA, and I will make a motion that this goes back to the ZBA for a decision, and they don't need our yes or no on their decision.
Well, I'm not sure we make a motion, and I think it's under the purview of the ZBA as to whether or not they choose to hear this, but I think we can request what...
Well, no, they're waiting from a recommendation for us about this contract, and I don't think there's anything there to recommend.
David, what are you going to... We haven't discussed this yet.
We haven't discussed it yet.
It's on a future agenda.
The ZBA has its own process, and any vote that the select board may make tonight only begins a process that has to be observed with the Zoning Board of Appeals. So, you know, I don't, you know, I understand what you're saying, but I don't see the point of the...
I think we're in the process. I don't think we have anything to add to a ZBA hearing as a select board. They're an independent board that is going to make this decision, as Mr. Neihardt said, and we can remedy this whole situation by letting it go forward to the ZBA and render a decision. If they accept Mr. Greenbaum's proposal, then the fire station is out, probably.
But you need to,
yeah, go ahead, Tim.
Can I clear up something? The primary reason the ZBA wanted some direction from you primarily is because you are the owners of that property. Okay, if that's there, if that agreement was signed, then he has some type of ownership there, and he can go forward with that variance. So the issue is, you vote to allow him as the owners to go forward to get that variance heard by the ZBA that's legal. Okay, remember, you are the owners. He's not right now. So say that he can go in front of the ZBA to go for that variance on the number of apartments, then that's fine. The other one, I think, needs a little bit more direction, because when you look at that, you are actually defining a specific location of the two non-conforming lots. You can't go in front of the ZBA and say, we want to make two non-conforming lots, but we don't know where the line is between the two. And that's where you guys have to come in. Right. So there is distinction between those two. Mm-hmm. And it's very clear cut, in my opinion, as how it has to proceed. Mm-hmm. So we can get the ZBA back on board very quickly, get that decision made on the number of the allowance of units. Mm-hmm. You guys can negotiate the number of units.
Right.
If that is voted no, you're all set.
Yep. So I'm fine with that process. Is there any disagreement?
I'll make a motion to have Mr. Greenbaum go before the ZBA with our permission to see if he can get the variance he needs for the 10 units.
Okay. Is there a second on that?
No. Second it.
Okay. Any further discussion? No. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
No.
No. Okay.
Now I got a question.
Mm-hmm.
If the ZBA turns around and rejects that proposal, is Mr. Greenbaum going to buy that property?
We'll deal with it then.
Well, it says right in the agreement he isn't.
We're going to be discussing the agreement.
Is
on
this
the 31st.
Going on at the same? By the way, you had Mr. Nixon sign on behalf of the selectmen for this zoning variance.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So, I mean, why are you saying that the zoning board needs their permission when they signed it already in the application? What do you mean you didn't know? You filled it out. Of course you know.
Okay, so that's the next step, and then on the 31st we'll have this agreement on the agenda.
Of course I know.
Okay? All right, so we'll wait to see what the ZBA does in terms of scheduling. Okay?
We'll get it done.
Right? Everybody understand where we're going?
So you'll be in contact with Joel on when the ZBA...
That was a good idea I had, huh?
Thank you. Okay. All right, and John, thank you for, again, there's a lot of work that's going into this.
You're most welcome. most welcome.
Okay.
And all the members are important.
Exactly.
Thank exactly. You. Yeah. Okay. So, let's see, what else do we have here? So we have building inspector goals, DPW director goals. We're done with the abatement. We have municipal aggregation, the evaluation form, and the gas moratorium.
For clarity on the abatement, we did allow the sewer abatement.
Yes, we did, yeah. Okay. All right, so I would jump to, where's Tim and Marla?
Tim, go.
Yeah, Tim, right.
I'll go.
Okay. Tim, you want to go ahead?
Tim, you're up.
You want to get Marla so he can go home?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't see him, that's why.
Let him earn his money.
Okay. So Marla?
Right, he likes it.
Well, I still have to stay.
So Marla? Hey.
Marla.
Okay, meeting's still going on here. Marlo, so given the lateness of the hour and given the fact that, excuse me,
hey.
I'm sorry, we're trying to, thank you. We've already seen your goals. You submitted them previously. So at this point, I guess the question is, we just have a handful here. And did anybody have any questions or comments for Marlo about the goals that we
have? Right out there.
Okay, so you want to just rattle off the highlights.
Okay,
okay.
I'll just hit the main goals and
yep.
maybe a couple of bullets. If you want to ask me about the other bullets, that's fine if that works.
Yep.
Don't mention the word bullets right
yeah,
now.
You don't even, yeah.
That was a good time.
Okay.
Sorry.
Shoot them up.
Okay, so I'm here to present my goals and objectives for FY 2017 for the Department of Public Works. I have basically five goals with many objectives for them. The first one is to establish time management plan within the DPW. Some of these are already done. These goals and objectives are already done or they're in the process. So we've already got the work order system built. We're already using it. A small point within the next week or two we'll be up and running fully with work order system as far as taking in complaints or concerns of the citizens and moving forward to accommodate that. Again, I expected to have it by July 11th. We were up and running July 5th. Another system that we need to get up and running is the vehicles. I've had two or three conference calls on having some sort of maintenance program to track all our vehicles. I wanted to find something that would work for all the department's vehicles because we also take care of police, fire, and some school buses. So I found a package. I just have to have one more conference call.
Mm-hmm.
Again, a lot of these are going to evolve around future budgeting or some capital and these goals and objectives.
Mm-hmm.
We're looking at around $2,500 a year to have a complete program to track all our vehicles, maintenance, costs, and everything that goes with it. Moving on, establish asset management plan. Our personnel and vehicles, obviously, are the most expensive assets in the DPW, outside of infrastructure. I'm in the process of developing a vehicle report to determine where our vehicles fall into capital going forward, the amount of vehicles we have, as far as do we have too many, do we have not enough. I'm into trying to find ways to buy a multi-piece type of equipment to replace. In other words, one to replace two. There's many pieces of equipment out there that I think we can do that with moving forward. I'm also evaluating staffing levels and how they're used in each division. As well as administratively and how it fits the department. I think there's some potential here for some change in the future that will make the department more efficient. This evaluation opens up the window for some successive planning within the department for the future. Job descriptions, real quick. The job descriptions, I think a lot of them fall into before we became a DPW. Some of them don't match the org chart, so I'm going to be working pretty hard to try and bring them up to speed, working with the town administrator, David.
Cross-training and licensing is another thing we're looking at. There is a lot of cross-training already that's been done. A lot of divisional employees are working in other divisions. But I need to look at the licensing end of it. Some of the licensing can be very tricky to obtain without working in that division full-time. So, in other words, a water or sewer license, certain licenses, the board had passed and won't prove it unless they work in that work for a full year. So I'm looking at things like that. Start infrastructure plan. This area is quite time-consuming, costly, and also a moving target for replacement, as we all know. It's always moving, always changing. The biggest point I want to make here is we have to know where, what, in the history of our infrastructure, just for starters. It'll be 6 months, the end of the month I've been here, and I have spent countless hours trying to find certain valves, certain pipes, certain manholes. When we get called and questioned on it, all our maps are in like 4 different buildings in town. I think it's very important that we start getting these maps and our infrastructure copied into the computer. We should be doing some GPS, GISing of our water, sewer, and drainage infrastructure. With our IT situation, we'll have to put that all in a cloud, which would be an expense at some point, but that's the end game.
Mm-hmm.
This could be a 2 or 3 year process, again, depending on when I present my capital, I'll have further explanation on how soon we can get there, how long it'll take us to get there on these things. The cost involved in these items it'll make up for itself in no time at all. An example is Route 9. I spent many hours trying to find things that weren't there during this project. I'm also in the process of evaluating the new MS4 permit requirements. We've got some newer information on that, which I can present at another time. One of my goals was to make sure we get through the permit and that we have it submitted by September of FY18. Again, funding that'll be requested in the fall. Continue working diligently with MassDOT on this project. I feel it's going quite well. I want to continue that good relationship that I've established with them going into the next project within 2 to 5 years, closer to 5 years at this point. Budget capital plan. I'm looking at different ways of stretching the precious dollars in each account that we have. We all know there's a lot of moving parts to the DPW. An example is, thank you again for the backhoe. We've already done seven hydrant and valve replacements and a couple of sewer repairs that would have cost us about $30,000 to go outside the department. So I want to continue to venture into being creative of moving staff around. Again, that cross-training thing, it's things are starting to progress and move ahead in that regard. The capital plan, I've completed it this week, or we're pretty close to completing it, working with Mr. Nixon. It may look significantly different next year. It may not. Again, I've only been here 6 months. I've been trying to gather all the information I possibly could to make that capital plan look like the priorities for the 6 years. Begin process of DPW building replacement. I haven't looked at that yet. I don't want to get into all that. So I take that back. It was kind of a joke. I've looked into it a little bit. There's a few options. Again, I haven't done much officially with it. I've had a few discussions with Mr. Nixon. I've had a few discussions with Jerry, my liaison. We're looking at a little bit further down the road on that because there's only 5 goals and objectives here, but there's a lot of work to be had to get into place. in closing, please accept these goals and objectives for myself and the department for FY 2017. They target efficiency, accountability, communication, and transparency. I will provide updates to the town administrator and the select board as we accomplish these goals and objectives. Thank you for the opportunity. If I've skipped over something you want to hear about, what is that?
Route 9. Paved today, going to be done tomorrow, right? No, I mean the base coat.
Second lift will be done tomorrow.
Okay, and that's where it's going to be left for the rest of the season, correct?
Yes, at that section, because they're going to be putting in curbing, raising structures, sidewalk work, sidewalk work starting at Wally coming this way as they tear up this intersection and 300 feet east of Town Hall here.
When are they tearing up this section?
They want to get this intersection done first. As you see, they've started on the north side. They're actually trying to dime that as they try and
so
pave
from this section to where?
300 feet.
About 300 feet
just
from 300 the intersection.
Feet. Okay.
Actually, the end point is like at the far corner of the fire museum.
And the other is slated 2 years from now.
Do I have a motion to
we're
approve?
We're looking at 4 or 5.
I got a couple
Marlo's
questions, too.
Make a motion to approve.
Motion and then we'll just discuss.
Make a motion to accept Marlo's goals.
Second.
Second, okay. Discussion, trip down.
Yeah, just the $2,500 vehicle maintenance project. I know it's a hypothetical question, but how much can that save us in money on a yearly basis, you think?
I think it will save the community a lot of money in the long run. You're looking at $350 per vehicle per month. So I did the figure on 60 vehicles. DPW doesn't have 60, but I'm going to grab the police and what fire and some of the school buses to get that in there. But what this system does is it tracks exactly what we put into each vehicle as far as parts, labor. In other words, a full dollar figure per year. So Chief Mason, Chief Spangnable, myself, we come to you wanting to replace a vehicle under capital. We will have accurate record keeping that will tell you, hey, this vehicle right here in Reading is costing you more to keep it on the road than it is to keep it. It will track everything from mileage to repairs to the hours worked on it. So in other words, every vehicle will have a complete history on it and it will hold it in the cloud. Right now, a lot of times it's paper record keeping. So things get lost in the shuffle, people get busy, they get running around. This will also help streamline the one mechanic we have with the administrator's help within the department to get that paperwork into the computer, I should say, or the work into the computer and the money so that we can track these vehicles. It'll be a significant save. $2,500, in all honesty, is a drop in the bucket to have 60 vehicles being washed like that.
I've also read your five-year plan in depth, and it's very aggressive for dealing with our infrastructure that we need to deal with. The only thing that I'm missing is cammering of our lines. Are you projecting to do some of that for preventive maintenance in the future?
Yes. We have I&I in my budget every year. I&I, you'll see in a line item number, there's I&I for that. And I think there's one item in there for this year for, I can't remember the amount, but it says Route 9. I wanted to start on a couple sections on Route 9. I think we spoke in a previous meeting, the section of the sewer on this end, I'd like to get a camera in line to protect it, again, they put so many utilities on that side with it. But there is room for that in the capital, plus we have it in the regular operating budget in wastewater every year.
And the last question I got, how are we doing with the licensing for the highway personnel to drive the tractor and the brush hog to clean our roads?
We got one, and he's been in it for a solid straight week, and we're getting some catch up on that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Put it to a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, we'll look forward to your updates, Marlo.
Yeah.
Marlo, can I have one of those? Because I couldn't.
You couldn't open it.
You can have the color copy. I'm sorry, you can have it.
Black and white.
Yeah.
He did vote.
Yeah. Okay.
I did want to add that the work order system, we've been working
said.
On it
yeah.
for quite a while. Mm-hmm. We were looking at a major expense for that. The department has never had a tracking software of any kind for, mm-hmm. for the workload. It's not the perfect system. It's something that I brought along from the previous community that was built by previous director of mine. Sharon has worked very hard to get this up and running. We've been tweaking it for a month. She loves the Access database thing, so that worked out really well.
Good.
We're tweaking it for the department. We're in full speed in the water department on it. And tomorrow, I did spend money on IT. Again, I'm trying to absorb as much as I can within my budget to get these things going. So it costs us a couple $1,000 to upgrade all our IT down there. We had home grade systems down there, and basically they just died. So I spent $3,500 on upgrading the IT, working with David on the five-year IT, knowing that we needed to do it to keep going. So everybody, we built a shared drive. So all the administrators, administrative assistants, and myself have access to this work order system for now.
Great.
So at some point, I want to get something out here on the website that, hey, we have a work order system now, we're tracking things, give us a call. I have a few samples here that I'll pass out, and I think I've taken enough of your time on that, but I wanted to get that out there that
okay, good.
That's very important.
All right, thanks, Marla.
Welcome.
You hit that button.
The air? Yeah.
Can you open the door back to
thank you.
Yeah, I hit it four times.
So, Tim, you want to recap yours quickly as well?
Yes, real quick. So, the nice thing about my department, I generate a lot of money in fees. Basically, I usually cover my department budget, which is very simplistic. I don't have much there. Office supplies and the like. I am looking forward to the day that we have a town-wide data system on board that we can get all the information relative to every parcel out there for everybody to see and be able to file within each property. It is cumbersome the way we work now, and you all know that. It's all paper.
Mm-hmm.
We generate a tremendous amount of paper. If we had that, I think a lot of time could be saved. And that day will come, and we'll be able to jump on it. The other major issue in my office is the back room and the storage and the filing of all the documentation. We are, by statute, cannot throw any piece of paper out relative to any parcel of land. So that room is filled, and it is getting stuffed quickly. There is discussion in town and hope that someday we'll be able to go forward with some type of electronic data. And we've talked, Marlo and I have just discussed it slightly, but of course we have to have some system in place. It might be something in-house. It might be an outside firm, but we're looking into that. David and I have also talked quite lengthy at that. We've had some old pricing on how to scan all the documentation, but it's also something I'm thinking that certainly Marlo can use in the other departments, that it might be something that with the price tag of these scanners, these large formatting scanners, dropping dramatically, mm-hmm. which we can get under $9,000, it might be wise to do something in-house,
mm-hmm.
and get somebody that's can over time get everything on electronic. But that is something that's going to take some time, and I'll be looking forward to the day that we can do that. Some of the things I'm concerned about for future is, especially as with zoning, I think that we've had our zoning and we've had lots of changes, but it might be time to discuss getting a committee together of residents and everybody to review what we have and see if we can make things a little bit more user-friendly and also protect some of the areas that I've shown here, i.e. downtown West Street, the Honey Pot area, that is still open to some type of development, and it's not closed off. We haven't had that problem only because the economy went south for quite some time. It is picking up.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as that gets saturated, I think people might start looking down to some of these regions, and it might be wise to try to nip that in the bud. We're always going to have some good permits process, renovations and everything down there. I can see that starting to really pick up right now. And we're running lean, and you guys know it as much as I do. I can only do so much in a day, and a lot of the stuff is by complaints.
Mm-hmm.
If that is something that we want to look at in the future, do some proactive issues, it just means more personnel to do it. I think we've been doing pretty good at what we need to do at this point. The first thing I have in there is certainly to do the things that we can do quickly, review the fee schedules and the like, try to get the budget under one line item more than we have mine under one number, electrical under another, and
plumbing
and everything. And it might be something that I think there could be benefits of putting it all on one. So that's something I can certainly discuss with David, and I'm sure there's more than one side to why that. I'm not an accountant, so he can.
Budget season starts in 2 months.
Stop.
Yeah, seriously. Any questions for Tim on his recommendations? Okay, if none, a motion?
Motion accept.
Second.
Thank you.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you very
Thank
much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You think a private committee is the way to go with the zoning issues rather than the planning board developing a strategy with that?
I think it's always wise to have residents involved. If we can get them involved and see the other side. John's here from the planning board. I think you.
We're working on a master plan right now.
Yeah.
We're trying to address a lot of those things you're talking about.
Well, that's good.
And we did talk in detail about putting all these plans. We got mountains of plans. We can't share them. The public can't share them.
Yeah,
and that is what he said there. That is really needed. We have a whole room this size loaded with plans that we have to keep. You know, and it's a big problem. People out there should go right on the internet and
be able to
save him trouble of digging out, save the planning board trouble. They would go on there and they could get all the information they wanted.
Well, it's also going to help
that's
all the departments
a lot
too.
Of money to tie.
Right.
Everything's right. Going to be tied into this, into the municipality.
Okay.
Every department will benefit from it.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So just a couple of remaining items, and then we have an executive session scheduled tonight. Jane?
Well, I'm here as the chair of the building committee of the senior center, and the municipal building committee and the select board had asked the senior center to try and get a proposal ready for fall meeting.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm here to find out the status of the OPM, because we're ready to meet with that person. How do we do that?
So we'd actually talked about that a little bit earlier. So the OPM agreement is...
You've approved it. It's going to be signed tonight.
Yeah.
If you want to work with me and David Tudrin, we'll provide you...
But you're going on vacation.
But I have a cell phone.
Okay, because it's 10 weeks to town meeting. And I know John needs to meet with an OPM too,
mm-hmm.
because we both have projects we want to put on the town floor.
Yeah.
Right.
So
Suzanne has my cell phone number.
As do I.
Okay, good. That's the way to get in touch with me. Remember,
right.
3-hour time difference between here and California.
And you're traveling tomorrow, so we can't talk tomorrow.
Well, you can if, let's see, I arrived there at 11 o'clock, so what does that make that?
And he didn't tell you he ain't coming back.
2 o'clock in the afternoon.
All
right.
So
email.
So it is being signed tonight, and there's no reason to believe we couldn't possibly meet with this person next week.
He can't.
Yeah, no, he can't. But
we don't need him to meet with the building committee and.
Well, the control over the hours of the OPM needs to be centralized, so that otherwise
won't be the first time.
We could get out of hand. So. You're
yeah.
okay coordinating that?
How many yeah, so we'll
is this
we'll
guy going to work on?
Okay.
Yes, Superman.
All right.
Thank you.
Yep. Okay, so municipal electricity aggregation. This is just perfunctory,
okay,
right?
So this is just an item that is part of our aggregation proposal to the Department of Public Utilities. We have to give the public notice that we're embarked on this project, and the project again is to see if we can combine Hadley's residential electric customers with together, as well as combine them with other towns in order to aggregate or purchase power so that people can save money on their electricity bills. There will be a bidding process. We'll go through a number of steps, but one of the steps we have to do is inform the public that we're going to be doing this. So we're going to be making this available on HPAT. We're going to have an announcement that will go out and be published on the website. We're making the announcement tonight at the select board meeting, and we'll follow it up at your next meeting.
Excellent.
Okay. No newspaper postings?
We can send out a press release.
Okay. Town administrator evaluation form. This is just a follow-up item. So there are some minor modifications based on feedback from some of the select board members. And what we've done is just added an additional category, evaluation category of needs improvement. Last time it was just doesn't meet, and then it jumped to meets. So we're adding something in there to as a further gradation. And then also the goals and objectives, the specific bulleted ones that David presented at the beginning of the year, or actually I think it was probably August or September, are going to be 35% of the evaluation weighting, and then 65% for his day-to-day responsibilities, because math didn't really work very well last time, and that seems to be more reflective of the evaluation process, so heavily weighting to how he's doing his day-to-day job. So those are the two changes that we have. So I would propose that at in September, try to get that evaluation done. So obviously not for August 31st, but what we did last time is people completed it on their own, then they submitted it to me.
To the chair, right.
Assimilated them, and but again, they, you know, the each one of them stood on its own, and they were a matter of public record. So it's really just for presentation purposes. Okay, so people comfortable with that? You want to pick a date in September to have them done?
Not really. What are our dates of our meetings?
So you're meeting
September.
On the 7th, the 14th, and the 21st.
I would say the 21st, after the public forum and everything.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. Okay, gas moratorium.
We have a guest here from Montague.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I didn't realize we had company.
No, I was going to give you a warning that I would definitely be coming.
Oh, okay. All right.
I'm Arielle Elon. I'm the Montague Pipeline Liaison, and that's an out-of-date title, but my board asked me to chase down the Energy Committee if I wanted to be called Energy Policy Liaison, and they're on hiatus all summer.
Okay.
So wanted to make sure I didn't step on their toes.
Yep.
I am in total empathy with what a long select board meeting is like, so I'm sorry to bring forth a substantive issue this late in the meeting, but I did drop in on Tim and on David last week to alert them to the fact that there is an opportunity at the Massachusetts Department of Public Utilities for the moratorium towns to challenge Berkshire Gas's mm-hmm. continuation of the moratorium on new and expanded service. And, you know, this is a formal legal proceeding. The DPU is reviewing Berkshire Gas's five-year forecast and supply plan. It's a routine procedure that they have to do every 2 years. What's not routine about it is that, of course, Berkshire Gas had been making they've been making a claim for a number of years that they can't even let people transfer service from one spot to another because they needed supply from this enormous pipeline that was proposed to go through Franklin County. That pipeline was canceled. They're still doing nothing to open up the tap again. And my town, Montague, actually was an accepted legal intervener in a previous Department of Public Utilities proceeding that concerned one of the contracts Berkshire Gas wanted to make to get supply from the pipeline. We developed really good testimony through an expert witness in that case that showed very clearly from materials that are partly actually on the public record, showed very clearly this company has had other options they have talked about in order to expand their supply in the places where they need a little extra on peak days. And the entire issue is about peak days. Some winters we don't even get them. Past winter we had no constraints at all in terms of falls because it didn't get cold enough. Mm-hmm. So this enormous imposition by this company on ratepayer communities that have done no harm to Berkshire Gas, you know, is all rooted in a particular way they wanted to handle peak day constraints, and they decided they wanted to buy 2% of what was going to go through this massive pipeline instead of do these other measures that they've talked about, that consultants have discussed with them for 6 years now. So, mind you, you know, as soon as we knew this proceeding was coming up, my board went right in because we've just produced this excellent testimony. We have evidence already that the DPU did not get to rule on in the contract case because the pipeline was canceled. There was no contract anymore. So it was, a really reasonable choice for us to enter to intervene. And I'm just visiting other moratorium communities and saying, would you, you know, do you want to co-intervene with us? You could also do it on your own. Now, the deadline for filing that petition to intervene was yesterday, but it is totally possible to approach the DPU to late file and say, we weren't aware. We still have a substantial unique interest in being in this proceeding. And I think particularly if you ended up wanting to join the filing of Montague, Deerfield also on the 10th of August voted to enter. And I think you might have seen Gazette coverage. Mm-hmm. Montague and Deerfield are working together. Amherst decided they were going to be completely independent, but would also file to intervene yesterday. Mm-hmm. And you might have noticed legislative delegation also decided to file. Now, it's very interesting because it's a really unusual thing for a group of legislators to try to enter as legal parties whose testimony must be heard, who can do discovery. You know, if you're a legal intervener, you get privileges to have your voice heard and examined by the Department of Public Utilities that you don't get by testifying at the public hearing, for example, that they're going to have on this matter in Greenfield August 30th. It's important to go and testify at the public hearing, but it does not have the legal weight that the commissioners have to consider it. And they don't, people at a hearing don't get to cross-examine Berkshire Gas as witness and testimony, and vice versa. This is a complete, being a complete party. So we don't even know if the legislators will be accepted as interveners, but it's striking that this is a large enough issue for people in all of their communities that they would take that step.
Yeah, we've been harassing them, so I'm sure you have as well.
Absolutely, yeah. Everybody has.
So what's it about?
We have businesses that, I mean, this is nothing new to us. We've been businesses that haven't been able to have it. We have people on Route 9 that have our 55 and older housing. They're looking to build and have gas on there. So, you know, we're certainly after them to open up because that's why we have Route 9 and our businesses on Route 9.
Do you by any chance happen to know how 8 communities were targeted for that?
Knowledge or speculation?
No. Whatever would be most helpful.
There's a back story to the size of this pipeline. Berkshire Gas's contracts would only have used 2% of it. There's a utility in New Hampshire that would have used a little bit. Columbia Gas would have used a little bit. There were some electric companies that wanted to buy in a little bit if they could have gotten to charge their ratepayers a tariff to build the thing and then to get the electricity that was generated by the gas through the thing. So they wanted to double bill ratepayers. That was called the pipeline tax. The Supreme Judicial Court actually just today ruled that no, that was not a good idea. But it's still a possibility because they can still push the legislature to try to establish that. So what it looks like, and my board chair said this, and you can see it, and I'll give you the articles in our news release. You know, how did he put it? There's a legitimate business question of whether Berkshire Gas is waiting around until economic conditions become favorable for another major transmission line that will deliver most of its gas to the coast for export. And the reason they might be doing that is they're owned by a major multinational energy company called Iberdrola, which specialize in big wind, that's true, but they also specialize in importing and exporting natural gas all up and down Europe. So there are reasons to think that the commitment to that pipeline was very much about what Iberdrola wanted to do with the gas that would not be consumed here in New England.
And
we
have the taxpayers pay for it.
What? Mm-hmm.
Sure.
And have the taxpayers pay
and
for that.
And have the taxpayers pay for
that pipe. Mm-hmm. And then they would profit. huge notes on our backs.
So if we want to co-intervene, what's involved?
Get in touch. You know, you'd have to take a vote to do that.
Sure.
You know, and you probably wouldn't do that this evening, but
why not? Let's go for it.
Our initial entry, and then we would link you with the attorney that's handling this for us, who handled our previous DPU intervention. You could ask him any questions you wanted. Initially, Montague and Deerfield co-entered on a small grant that was provided by a private donor that can cover a couple of weeks, but then we have to start looking at how do we get together and fund this. Some of that also can be raised from donations. When Montague did our first intervention, the contract intervention, I was coordinating fundraising, and a number of individuals, foundations, small businesses did pitch in. We opened, I forget what it's called. It's a specific account under a specific law that a town can open for a public project of the town.
Enterprise?
We opened an account to receive donations. Yeah, and had some fundraisers and reached out and did pretty well with it, actually. Helped a lot.
Mm-hmm. God, I don't have time for fundraising. Can't think of it.
What type of money are we talking?
Start to finish, including if there has to be an SJC, if it's recommended to have an SJC appeal. A proceeding like this can go $80,000 to $120,000. If that included an appeal for everyone involved.
Tim?
And I think that our businesses along here, and some of the prices that they have told me, if we reached out, I think we probably can get quite a bit, because even the mall, they were looking at $100,000 just to revamp what they have to get one store in.
Right.
And if they keep, I mean, that's crazy.
I didn't even realize the costs were that high to shift to propane. Oh,
some of them can't do propane there. Right. So they have to go to electric. Now you're bringing in, it's just astronomical amounts of money that these larger retail establishments are looking at.
They're going to electric, and they put up a few solar panels while they're
working. They are looking.
We got lots of them.
Yeah.
But it's in the meantime.
Yeah, no, it's this is really tough.
Yeah. So thank you for reaching out. We appreciate you coming to the meeting. And I guess the question is, I mean, I know how I feel about this, but what's the pleasure of the board in terms of taking any action? David, do you recommend that we hold off, or?
No, I think that we should explore getting that intervener status, because so much of our economic development is closely tied to the availability of gas. And with the moratorium, you're beginning to see the effects of it up and down Route 9.
Anyone want to make a motion?
Sure, I'll make a motion to join co-intervener.
What's
the gas moratorium? Mm-hmm. Is there any cost to it?
Not right now. Each town is going to have to evaluate in consultation with the attorney and with each other. Is this looking like a good investment? And we think it's a good investment. Right. But
and we would have the opportunity to drop out if those costs were prohibitive.
You can hit the soak
this is just to move.
Yeah. So we could drop out if we need to. So that would be my motion.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I should have had asked for a second on that.
Friendly motion to amend to explore the opportunity.
Well, we can still go forward, but you can still drop out, too.
Second.
Okay, any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. We're in.
So somebody, that's wonderful. Somebody contact me so I can get you hooked up with a lawyer to file
Jennifer?
A petition.
Jennifer?
Yep.
For late entry.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks
I'm
for taking
sorry,
the time tonight to join us.
Thank you very much for having me.
Appreciate it. Okay, so with that then, announcements, and then we will be going into executive session. John, what?
Can I ask a question? I asked once for the selectmen's meeting to either vote up this project or vote it down.
When are we're gonna have further discussion on August 31st, right?
No, I mean, are you supporting it to go to the ZBA?
They do.
No, they voted for green bonds.
My understanding is that you're both going to go in.
I know, but I asked also to be on agenda for the selectmen to either endorse this project or reject this project? Or we were just wasting our time?
No, I don't think you're wasting your time, but I think we want to find out how the zoning board looks at it.
Well, if the zoning board votes no, it's everybody's fired. Goodbye. Go home.
Right, but we also want to find out what their ruling is on Joel Greenbaum's project.
They also want to know if the selectmen support this. Do they?
I'm not in a position tonight to tell you that. I mean, we need input from the rest of the community out over there, John. You have a building that I think is big. Is there any modification? Can you make it smaller? Is there anything else you can do? We have an OPM that's going to look at your site and see if it's going to work on the site. We got the buildings committee that doesn't support putting it on that site, the size of it. We don't know if we're going to tear down North Hadley Hall or not tear down North Hadley Hall. Mm-hmm. I don't fight it, John. I am not against your project. But I'm not.
Did I say anything?
No, no, no.
Then don't get off me.
Please accept my apologies.
Right.
I'm not in a position tonight to make a decision, yes or no. And that's no reflection on anything with your presentation tonight. Or anything at all like that.
Right. That's why I broke out the questions the way I did, because again, I'm for North Hadley Hall Fire Substation. I like the building. You know, I have a couple questions on the size of it, but I'm questioning right now the lot size, and so my thought process is very dependent on.
Well, there's a.
And I'm certainly in favor. I'm certainly in favor of the concept of it, and of the building, and of the process that you've started. And to see where it's going to go.
Okay, so any announcements?
The building committee's meeting last night, they asked if we could set up a date where we could walk through the buildings in the community. Mm-hmm. They've done a walkthrough before, and they were hoping on either September 10th or September 17th. If that would work so that we could do a walkthrough. They could point out some of the things that they were looking at for projects to be done.
Okay, I can do it. I've got an evening commitment on the 10th.
This is the, it would be in the morning. Hopefully.
What day are we in September?
Yeah.
10th or 17th.
I'm gone on the 17th, but the 10th I can do. How about everybody else?
10th work for you, Donald?
That's fine.
Okay. That's a Saturday.
Saturday, yeah. Mm-hmm. That should be no problem.
I am gone.
So we'll shoot for the 10th, whoever's able to make it. Maybe John will be able to make it as
9 o'clock? What time?
Yeah, let's set it up for 9. If that works, please. Okay. Were you able to speak to Mr. Tudrin today? Or interact
yes.
with him? Okay.
Yeah.
So you know about the two Warren articles that they're looking to be have brought forward?
I haven't seen them yet.
I have copies of them here.
Yes, please.
Okay. It's announced for tonight. Did I miss from last night?
I don't think so.
Okay. Any other announcements?
Just a couple of cleanup issues. Did we take a vote on the abatements?
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
No.
She's saying no.
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 Yeah,
oh. I'm not taking a vote on it. I'm sorry.
Okay. So anyone
as
want to make
as per the recommendation
of the water
did it
department?
Come from Susan or did it come from the water department?
It came from DPW
waters
right together.
As per the recommendation of the Water and DPW Department, I would like to put forward their recommendations.
Mm-hmm.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
That's less complicated than trying to figure out who's got water, who's got sewer.
Exactly.
Okay.
So
as per the written.
So that the next one is, did we get a vote on the consent agenda?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. And then the third one is, while I'm on vacation, it's customary that you vote to allow the town collector to sign on my behalf.
Motion to that effect?
So moved.
Town collector?
Town collector.
Yeah, Sugulowski.
Okay.
Second? Is that a second? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And you're coming back when, David?
Coming back on the 28th, technically the 29th, about 12:05 a.m.
Lovely.
Yeah.
Okay, if no further announcements, then do we have a motion to move into executive session? Was there a last one?
Did you do this before?
No.
I'm sorry?
We didn't have this item on for quite a while, correct?
I'm sorry, I'm not sure.
The executive session topic, we haven't discussed it.
No, this is a new executive session.
Oh, new one.
No, she, so would somebody like to make a motion, Joyce? You can.
Oh, you want this?
Yes. Wasn't it just postponed because Mr. Neihardt was on vacation?
Yes, so we never had it.
And that was the only reason we never had it.
Oh, shoot. Okay.
Oh, do you want, actually, what, Jerry, do you want to do it? Sorry, Joyce, you fired.
I got it, yeah.
The select board will enter into executive session as per provision of Mass General Law, Chapter 30A, Section 21A3, to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining, litigation, if an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the bargaining and litigation position of the public body, and as so the chair declares.
Oh, there's my declaration. Dang. Okay, as chair of the Hadley Select Board, I declare that continuing this discussion in open session would have a detrimental impact on the town of Hadley.
Roll call vote, Devine?
Yay.
Keegan?
Yay.
Sean Glover?
Yep.
Paczynski?
Yay.
Okay, thank you, everybody.
You.